It is almost two decades now that she has been part of our lives, and Wimbledon has been part of hers. Chris Evert, teenage clay court specialist, who found that grass could sometimes be greener, though that was not often the case. We have watched her grow up here through 17 semifinals, 10 finals, and 3 championships. The history of Chris Evert at Wimbledon is one of unbridled joy and extraordinary frustration, both on and off the court. At the age of 17, her Wimbledon era began. She had no concept of what was in store.
I never was nervous back then. You know, I was too young. I was too dumb to know. You know, I wasn't in touch with my really innermost emotions, I don't think. I just went out there and played, and I was totally oblivious to who I was playing and the fact that if the queen was in the audience, I wouldn't have known or wouldn't have cared at that point.
What the 17-year-old Chris Evert did care about was a certain young tennis player from Belleville, Illinois. 19-year-old Jimmy Connors lost to Ilie Nastasi in the quarterfinals that year, but a great friendship was born. 2 years later, now engaged, Chris and Jimmy made Wimbledon 1974 more than memorable. Evert beating Olga Morozova for the women's title.
Oh, it's a good one.
Connors defeating 39-year-old Ken Rosewall for the men's crown. An American sweep, a tennis love story for all time. The afterglow was extraordinary.
I just remember we were posing for the press, and I had the plate, and he had the trophy, and it was causing such a commotion, and I think at that point I realized that we were sort of a big deal, you know, that that was really a fairy tale, and we were both American, and we were both young, we were engaged to one another, and how many times does that happen in a lifetime? When you look at pictures of that time and you see yourself there with the long ponytail, I mean, can you believe that that really ever happened to you? At 19, I didn't have a clue, you know? I mean, that was my first love, and I just fell into it, you know, head over heels, and let my emotions rule everything else. And I just, it was wonderful. At the time, it was wonderful. And I'm very glad the way that it ended up. I think we're both better off.
Hopefully she's as happy as I am and will continue to be so. But for the relationship that we had in the past and the friendship that hopefully we will continue to have throughout the rest of both our lives will always be there and something that will be there long after the tennis is over, and that's what's important.
Too much tennis intensity in one place sent them on separate paths. The next few years for Evert were spent alone and marked by single-minded determination towards her sport. By 1976, she was in the winner's circle again, Yvonne Goolagong-Cawley, the victim, in a tough three-set match.
That's it. Game, set, match.
The British press, though, did not take kindly to Evert's cool court demeanor and started calling her the Ice Princess, Little Miss Icicle.
When you come over here and you play Wimbledon, you're a target. You know, it's not only, well, Chrissy really hit her forehand down the line well today, it's Chrissy's gained 10 pounds, or Chrissy's dating so-and-so, or, you know, they want to write about every single thing, and maybe my mistake was reading all the tabloids, you know, but it's kind of hard when you walk in the dressing room and, like, all the girls are reading these headlines and you happen to be in the headlines.
In the beginning, they were very tough on her. You know, they called her the Ice Maiden. They were horrible to her. I mean, I was really upset. I used to go in the dressing room and say, I can't believe this. They're really being unfair to you. And it bothered her in the beginning. And then as we get older, we realize it's just the media and they have to do whatever they have to do and not read anything if you're smart. But Chris always liked to read everything. I said, Chris, don't read it. Don't listen. She couldn't help herself.
She couldn't help herself 2 years later when, ironically, a young Englishman came into her life. Chris and John Lloyd met at Wimbledon 78. It was also the year that marked the first of many losing center court struggles against Martina Navratilova. John was on hand for and may have helped contribute unknowingly to that first loss.
Chris really had her in that match, and the Chris that we know would normally have won that match, but Maybe I had a little bit to do with that because there are a few things going on. Well, we started going out during those 2 weeks. Really, her mind wasn't really on it. And I think she was almost happy that Martina won it. And I think if she'd had that back again, Martina would never have taken the title that first time.
I was lonely at the time, and so was he. And we're both, again, we're both looking for the right person, and it was the right time.
A year later, she returned as Mrs. Lloyd and proceeded to lose again to Martina in the final. The following year, 1980, she was so happy to have eliminated Navratilova in the semis that she played in a daze against Ivan Colley, losing the championship for the third year in a row. But 1981 would be different. As Mrs. Lloyd, she breezed through the tournament without losing a set, methodically disposing of Hanna Manlikova to capture her third Wimbledon title. Suddenly, the once disdainful British press was treating her like a native daughter. She was even having tea with Princess Di.
She was really shy the first time I met her, and she was very talkative and maybe saying too much. You know, I asked her, I said, why isn't your fiance here? Why isn't Charles here? And she says, oh, he thinks tennis is silly, you know, and he just doesn't like it. And I remember telling the press our conversation. I was naive. They said, what did you talk about? And I told them, the press. And then it was sort of headlines the next day, and someone came up to me and said, the next time you talk to royalty, try to, you know, be a little more quiet. And you're not supposed to really blab what you've talked about. So I learned my lesson.
By 1985, the relationship between Chris and John Lloyd had ended, but a stronger bond persisted on the court. Chris and Martina, inexorably intertwined in the history of Wimbledon. After two losses in the 70s, Chris lost three more championship matches to Martina between 82 and 85.
I think we pushed each other to greater heights. If Martina hadn't come along and it had been too easy for me, maybe I would have stopped playing, I would have gotten bored. And vice versa, if I didn't stay on the scene, maybe Martina would have gotten bored. You know, everyone talks about Steffi Graf and winning the Grand Slam, and Martina and I never won a Grand Slam, but we've had longevity.
I honestly wish that I would win Wimbledon one more time and Chris would win it one more time. Then we can go out and be happy. You could almost go to both our lives and just pan on the 2 weeks during Wimbledon and see how we've grown over the years. We've done a lot of growing up here.
Though Wimbledon titles have been elusive for Chris through most of the 80s, personal happiness has not. Her marriage to former world-class skier Andy Mill has made a declining career that much easier to handle.
The one regret I have about Andy is I haven't won a Grand Slam since I've met him. And it's been 3 years almost, it's been 2.5 years. And I keep saying to him, you know, I've had a great career, but I wish I could just raise that plate or that big trophy over my head for you one time, you know, because that would mean a lot to me.
I'd like to see her hold one up for herself, you know, because she's played, I think, really knowing Chrissy as well as I do, she's played for a lot of other people. I'd like to see her just play for herself.
Her success has also given parents Jimmy and Colette prideful years, loving memories, and hopes for the future.
I was in Fort Lauderdale, and she called me on the phone, and at that time she was only 19, and that little voice said, didn't say hi, Dad, or anything like that. She said, I won. And I just got all choked up. I couldn't believe it, and I really couldn't talk to her for a while, and she said, Dad, are you all right? And finally I got myself together and we talked.
My main concern is Chrissy's happiness. And if it's work, if she has that worried look on her face, I'd rather have her retire. You know, I know it probably wouldn't be a storybook ending, but if she could live up to her seating, say, in this Wimbledon, I think she'd be really happy. And I would be happy for her.
Chris knows that the end is in sight. Her career and her Wimbledon history almost over. But she will only say goodbye on her terms. The right time, the right place, no regrets.
At times it's been a strain, and at other times it's been easy. But, you know, when I come back to Wimbledon as a spectator, for whatever reason, and I'm 36, 37, 38, I'll know that I gave it all that I had.
Ultimately, that is her legacy. She has shown us the true heart of the consummate competitor. Fierce, tough, relentless. She has persisted through almost two decades at Wimbledon, and there never was any doubt that she gave it all that she had.